Something's going on with this river that hasn't been happening before. And I don't know what it is. Sometimes they call it a death by a thousand pinpricks. But something big is hitting the river right now.
We have in the past seen fish kills after a bloom of any sort. This is the strongest I've ever seen, so I expect to see a pretty good fish kill from this one.
Clearly, we see lots of green coloring, clumping, streaking in the water. This green that we're seeing is due to chlorophyll, which are in these single-celled phytoplankton so that they can photosynthesize. And in small amounts, they're totally natural and healthy for an ecosystem. But at elevated levels, they cause problems. Some of them have toxins. And when they get broken down by bacteria, the bacteria consume oxygen from the water, and those cause fish kills.
For over 15 years, my students and I have been studying algal blooms in Tennessee, New York, and Florida. What we're seeing right now in the St. Johns River rivals any that I've seen anyplace else.
Follow us as we join Dr. Melinda Simmons as we go along the river with the St. Johns Riverkeeper, as well as Riverkeeper volunteers who live on the river. We'll show you spots along a 70-mile stretch of the St. Johns, from above the water, under the water, and we'll see what these algae look like through a microscope. And what we'll show you, I consider a disaster. These algal blooms are massive. They're forming nerve toxins and liver toxins, and they're blocking out the sunlight, which impacts all of the vegetation underneath, as well as many other animals. What we're finding is algae everywhere. Let's start at Lake George.
I'm Deanne Clark. This is April Kirkendall. We live on Drayton Island. I've lived here about 13 years.
I've been here about 11. I do the mail, so I deliver mail by boat to Drayton Island 6 days a week.
I'm on the water a few days a week. This bloom that we have today is probably the worst that I've seen.
Worse than normal. We typically get algae blooms in the summertime, but it's just kind of adds to the murk to the water, but it doesn't really get to this level where you're starting to see the sheets on the water.
This is Drayton Island that we're going to be going around. That's off to our right.
Can you see a lot of algae now?
Yeah.
The green clumps in the water make me suspect a microcystis bloom. And that suspicion is confirmed. This is particularly troubling because microcystis can produce liver toxins. Here we have a dying microcystis colony of mini cells surrounded by individual microcystis cells. Seeing this isn't surprising, since this commonly forms blooms in the St. Johns River.
Yeah, my name is Mike Stallings, and I've basically been on these two rivers all my life, grew up on them. And this is probably one of the worst algae blooms I've seen. It's definitely the earliest. Normally, we see it around August.
We are at Ouellette Spring. We can see with our own eye that there is a problem going on here. There's clumps of algae in the water. It looks like split pea soup. The tree trunks and water lilies are painted a turquoise color. So this looks like a phanizomenon, which looks like little grass clippings.
In addition to a phanizomenon, the sample also has microcystis and dolichospermum.
I'm a scuba diver, and the areas that we dive is approximately 30 to 50 feet, and this algae goes from surface to the bottom. We went from the wintertime having 3 feet of good visibility, and now we're at less than a foot visibility.
You can imagine if we can't see through the water, how organisms that need to find food from the air, such as osprey, may have a hard time locating prey flying above when the water is this cloudy with phytoplankton.
These lab reports definitively identify the culprits: the individual cyanobacterial species present, as well as the different toxins. Microcystins, cylindrospermopsin, and the potent neurotoxin, saxitoxin. Saxitoxins are nerve toxins that prevent your neurons from firing properly, so ingesting this toxin can cause numbness, tingling, incoherent speech, and even respiratory failure. Antitoxin A is another nerve toxin found in algal blooms. And microcystins and cylindrospermopsin cause a variety of toxic effects, including liver and kidney damage.
Sam Carr, I'm here in San Mateo. I've been here on the river for over 50 years. This, by far, has been the longest lasting algae bloom that I can ever remember. The very first time that we saw it was April the 10th, and all. And so here we are this morning on May the 6th. It was just about as bad this morning as it was on April the 10th. What has shocked me about this particular algae bloom is that it's not just on top of the water, it's down through the entire water column and all the way across the river. So this morning when we got up, there was a neon green sheen on the water, and you can see how it left it on my seawall. So now the tide has gone down and is now coming back up, but you can see the blue-green algae that is still left on my seawall. So this will probably wash away here in the next couple of hours. But sure enough, in the morning, guess what? It'll be back.
And you can
smell
it.
So it gets worse.
It.
Yes, you can. Initially, we couldn't smell it, but by April the 23rd is when I first walked out, and I could feel it. It gave me a headache almost immediately.
My name is Bob Vernstein. I worked at the Water Management District for 20 years. I'm retired now, but still dabble in science and do some consulting. We've lived here at this spot on the river near Forrester Point for 29 years now. And this is as dense as I have seen the algal bloom in all the times we've been here. Generally, it's in the summertime. So this, starting in April, Easter, this was early in the year.
Pretty visible front here where the green edge of the bloom is running up against the tannin-rich natural water of the river, but even in the tannin-rich part you can see clumps, and now we're just in the super thick bloom area. It's been 4 days since we were at Site 4, and now we're out on the main stem of the St. John's River.
So we're currently located right to the east here is the mouth of Julington Creek. Over here to the west is Doctor's Lake. Earlier this year, there have been reports of algae in this area, but right now we're not seeing any, but we're gonna continue to go upriver or go south to find the northern border of this early algal outbreak.
We are just east of Green Cove Springs by Popo Point. When we took a sample, we could see particles in the water. We're here off Watson Island in the St. John's River, and we chose to stop here because we did notice a green tinge to the brown tannin water. And we took a scoop in our clear container, and we were able to see green particles with the naked eye without the aid of a microscope. Not huge globs like we sometimes see, but still an apparent bloom. Now we're at Middle Point, roughly 8 miles north of Palatka, and we're seeing similar bloom organisms that we did in the samples on Monday. So this looks like a phanizomenon, which looks like little grass clippings in the water column. Do you see that, Lisa?
I do, and that's consistent with what we saw last week at Racy Point, just north of here. So we're seeing this throughout this section of river.
Wow, so even at our lowest magnification for this microscope, which is 60x, I can see a lot of a phanizomenon. You see them as long greenish gold threads on the microscope. And this is what we saw on Monday at sites 2, 3, and 4. It's not something I would want to swim in.
Yeah, well, it's not something you want to see in our river. And sadly, this is consistent with the state data that's coming in since the beginning of this bloom earlier this April. And it's also the dominant species from the 2010 super bloom that was also associated with fish scales.
And since these can fix nitrogen,
there's no stopping them as long as there's plenty of phosphorus.
And phosphorus levels are elevated throughout the St. John's River. The Water Management District reports that's due to fertilizers as well as unsustainable use of biosolids, reclaimed water. So we have to do something to reduce phosphorus levels, or we're going to continue to see this in the St. John's.
So the Riverkeeper was talking about high phosphorus levels that the state reported and it being correlated with elevated algal blooms, and specifically F-anisomenon. And you mentioned that F-anisomenon fixes nitrogen. So explain the connection between all that.
Okay, so photosynthetic organisms, such as the bloom organisms we're seeing in the river right now, they need things like nitrogen and phosphorus, things we typically find in fertilizer that we might use on our lawns. But some of these organisms, like Dolichospermum, Aphanizomenon, they're able to use atmospheric nitrogen. That's the most prevalent gas in our atmosphere. So at that point, the only thing that's limiting them is phosphorus. And so if we have elevated phosphorus levels in our river, these organisms are going to bloom like crazy. And this is what we saw in 2010, a big bloom of Aphanizomenon over about a 70-mile stretch of the river.
And that's approximately the range that we covered on those two sampling trips.
Right.
So what's a summary of those nine sites that we stopped at over that 70-mile stretch on those 2 days? What's a summary of the type of cyanobacteria you did see?
I saw Aphanizomenon at 8 of 9 sites, and I saw Dolichospermum at a handful of sites, as well as Microcystis at a handful of sites. And this is problematic because Dolichospermum and Microcystis are both known to produce toxins.
Now, Aphanizomenon, though, the story's still out on that, because largely they're non-toxic.
Right. However, in a large enough quantities or in bloom quantities, they can still be harmful even if they don't produce toxins, because when they decay, it sucks up the oxygen in the water and it can still cause massive fish kills. And just as we saw Aphanizomenon and over that 70-mile stretch, they also saw that in 2010. So it was a very similar situation where water temperatures were very high, which is something we saw at all of our sites.
That's right. It was in the 80s. Like, the water temperature was super warm. And as Sam Carr said, you know, we had a very mild winter.
Yeah.
And he thinks that that's why it came so early. And we agree. And that's the thing. We're all wondering, us and many other scientists, is it going to be like 2010, where F-anisomenon takes that nitrogen out of the atmosphere, converts it to organic nitrogen when they die? It allows Microcystis, for example, to then rise in very high levels. So a lot of scientists right now are thinking that we're going to have some more massive blooms after the F-anisomenon dies.
There's a lot of concerned people.
So Microcystis, Aphanizomenon, Dolichospermum, Microcystins, anatoxins, saxitoxins, so toxins and microscopy. It takes a lot to be able to really identify all of these.
Absolutely.
Right here in our own backyard in Palatka, we have Green Water Labs, which is an internationally recognized algal bloom laboratory. And for our next video, we're going to go down there and we're going to talk to the scientists, and they're going to show us how they analyze blooms to identify the different species, as well as the different types of toxins that are there. So stay tuned for that.